So previous class we started discussing phase shift, H bridge, DC-DC converter. So this is especially used in electric vehicle charger applications and some other DC-DC power applications, right? So in this class we will discuss so how much amount of power so that is being transferred from this H bridge to this load, or from this DC to this load side. So this is the circuit. This is already we discussed that. So we have this input, right? Some filter. So this filter is optional, and we have this H bridge. So this is how we represent this H bridge. And we have this transformer, a high frequency transformer, and its turns ratio is 1:N. Okay. So the output is fed from a bridge rectifier, right? So here you will get a DC output. So how you will define the, so this is how you will define the power flow so between these two. So that all depends on the phase shift between these two input and output side, right? So the power flow is max, so the power flow is happening because of this leakage inductance of this transformer circuit and additional inductance. If you want to use this ZBS operations, we need to connect some additional inductor or some additional resonant inductor for that. So we can define this. So if you assume that is the 1:N transformer, so we can define this, the duty ratio, or this how much power that is being transferred. So what is the formula for this? What is the formula for output voltage V naught if the transformer ratio is 1:N? What is the formula? Might have studied this, right? So some duty ratio D into, so number of turns N into VI, right? So from this, this duty ratio is V naught by, so N into VI. Okay. So generally, so we can say that this, when D, so usually if D is less than 1, so we can say that it's a buck operation. And if it's a boost operation, so for D greater than 1. So let's come to these waveforms. This already we discussed that. Okay. So this is the first one is the input voltage, that is voltage across this A and G. So here you have this A and this is G. Okay. So that means we are measuring this voltage across this A and this ground. Okay, in other words, this voltage across the switch or this inductor and this combination, right? So this is the one, and similarly this B and G, this one. So we have the phase shift of this beta. We have the phase shift of this beta. Okay, so this beta is the equivalent voltage applied across this load is VAB. So this voltage, so that appears across this primary side is VAB. So that is difference between VAG minus VBZ. So this one. So this VSG minus VBZ. So that is the voltage applied across the primary winding. This is the voltage that applied across the primary winding. So here this, right. So therefore the phase shift between these two is the beta. The phase shift, the width of this pulse is between these two is the beta. This is the angle. So come to the secondary one. Secondary one is operated with a phase shift of phi. Secondary one is operating with a phase shift of pi. Since this is unidirectional power flow, so we cannot control the phase shift between these two. So usually this phase shift, so that is depending on the inductance value L and the load. Okay, so the equivalent voltage so applied across the load is VAB, and it has a pulse width of beta. So where this beta can be a controlled phase shift between the two, these poles, so that is A and B. So usually if it is operating with a resonant, so we can say that, so these are the resonant poles. Okay, so this already we discussed that. So this is the VA, so this primary voltage, and this will be the secondary voltage. So primary voltage and secondary voltage. So we are, so now drawing for the current waveform in the inductor. So usually we already discussed that the inductor waveform, the difference between the primary and the secondary, so will be absorbed by the inductor waveform. So this inductor waveform will be like this. Okay, so it is from here to here, it is increasing. From here to here, it is increasing. Okay, so this we basically obtain from the intersecting points of these two. So we already discussed this thing, right? So this how this inductor current will be in case of discontinuous conduction mode and continuous conduction mode. And we have this this continuous conduction mode in this case. Okay, the same thing I have drawn here. This is the inductor current. Okay, so this inductor current, okay, so it is basically, if you draw the current waveform for the primary current or this current or the source, how much current that is actually supplied by that, right? So if you notice that, so during this period, right, so during this period only, the this period, the power is feeding from the load to source, sorry, source to load. And here also the power is feeding from the source to load. So whereas here, so this is the freewheeling period. So here, again, this power is feeding from the source to, it means the power flow is happening between these two. And this one is the freewheeling period. So based on that, so we have three different regions or different modes of operation. So this is 1, 2, and 3. So we already discussed this. It's for continuous conduction mode, right? So this is 1, 2, and 3. So the same waveforms, but just I am drawing for a idealized case. So this is the output side, this current after the diode bridge rectifier. So this current is always, most of the times it is unidirectional, right? So therefore, so this is the primary current. Okay, so therefore this I naught will be like this after this diode bridge rectifier. And this is like this, this waveform is replicated. And this is this one, right? Again, this waveform is same. Whatever this waveform, so that is maintained same here. Okay, this is the current. It is going negative, right? So, but on the other side, you'll get a positive current. So this is simple, right? This is, if you assume that this is the power, or this is the current that drawing from the diode rectifier source side, the output side will be like this. If you remember that, if it is square wave, the supply current is square wave, on the output side, you have a constant I naught, right? So this is on the AC side, and this is on the DC side. The same thing here, if this is on the AC side, so what kind of shape you can get on the DC side, this is on the DC side. Okay, so this is exclusively on the source side, how much power started being transferred from the source to load. So these are the freewheeling times, so there is no power supply from the source side. So these are the devices that are being conducting. So when it is this case, we already discussed the T1, T4 are conducting. And so this freewheeling period, so T1, D3 are conducting. At the same time, on the load side, diode bridge rectifier, so we have this D1, D4 are conducting. So this D1 and D4 are conducting. Okay. So first these two will conduct. Okay, so after that, this T3 and these two will conduct. So these things are already we discussed. So these are the idealized waveforms, and we are divided this into three modes. So 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so this is the phase shift phi. This phase shift depends on the size or this inductor and this load, and this controlled phase shift. So that is we externally given this. Okay, so from 0 to theta, you have mode 1. From theta to, sorry, 0 to phi, we have mode 1. From phi to beta, we have another mode. And from that, beta to pi, you have the third mode. So this is phi, and this is beta, and you have, this is phi, beta, and this is pi. So during 0 to pi, okay, so how we will represent this inductor current? Before that, so we will draw the equivalent circuit for this circuit. So it will be like this. We have diode bridge rectifier on the on side. So we have diode bridge rectifier on the on side. So this transformer, if you're neglecting all the components, so we can actually replace with a inductor. On the other side, you have this bridge rectifier and load. So now we are referring this, of this is, let's assume that this is Vi. Okay, so this is V naught. So we are actually bringing this V naught to the primary side. So now this will become, so V naught dash. Okay. So this will become V naught dash. Agree? So what is V naught dash in terms of V naught? What is V naught dash in terms of V naught? If the ratio is 1 is to n, so what is V naught dash? If you are referring from the primary side,
V naught by n.
It's V naught by n, right? So we already this formula. That what is the formula for D? What is formula for D? Duty ratio.
V naught by n.
V naught by n into Vi, right? Okay.
Yes.
So from this, if you are trying to write in terms of V naught dash, so how you will write? So this V naught by N, right? So that means this D can be written as V naught dash by Vi. V naught dash by Vi. So this D is normally represent the primary referred DC voltage gain. So this is known as primary referred DC voltage gain. Primary referred DC voltage gain, so that's given by V naught dash by Vi. So V naught dash is the output voltage referred from the primary side. So we are assumed that, so this is 1 is to n transformer. Okay. So now if you consider that, so this 0 to pi period, so this period, so if you consider this 0 to pi period or this period, okay, so how you will write this current I of theta, right? See where this theta is the omega t. So that means this theta is the omega t. So where this omega is the switching frequency in radian per second. So how you will write theta? I of theta, and in other words, I of omega t. So here, see, we already discussed that. So this inductor current is the difference between the primary voltage minus the secondary voltage. So this is the primary voltage and this is the secondary voltage, right? So that means how we will write that? So this is Vi minus of this one, right? So this is V naught dash minus of minus, so therefore plus V naught dash, okay? So by into omega L into omega T and initial value, so I of zero. So this is from 0 to 5. Is correct? So this is the initial value, right? And this is inductor voltage, is difference between the voltage across this inductor is the difference applied between these two, right? So that means this is Vi. So this is V, this one is V naught dash, right? And this is minus V naught dash if you refer from the primary side. So this waveform, if you refer from the primary side, this will be right, this plus and this is minus. So therefore this Vi minus of minus V naught dash. So therefore Vi plus V naught dash divided by omega L into some theta. So that is omega T and its initial one. So that is I of zero. The same thing from zero, some phi to this beta. This is the second one. So this pi to beta. So this one we are talking about now. So how you will represent that? How we will represent that? How to represent that? This is the one, right? So this is Vi and this is V naught dash. So therefore Vi minus V naught dash by omega L, that is inductor, into omega T, right? So what is its initial value? So what is its initial value?
Zero.
It's not zero, right? What is its initial value before start of this one? So what is its initial value? So when you're starting from zero to pi, its initial value is I of zero, right? So this mode is between pi to beta. And now what is its initial value?
I of pi.
It is I of pi or I of pi. So it's I of pi, right? Its initial value is I of pi. But of course, this I of pi is zero. So now this beta to pi. So beta to pi, so what is its value? I of omega t.
Minus V naught by omega.
Minus? Minus V naught dash by omega L into omega T plus, what is its initial value? I of beta. So we have, this is for in mode 1 and this is in mode 2 and this is in mode 3, and this procedure is repeated, right? Again, this is 1, 2 and 3. So this is so repeating 1, 2 and 3 likewise. Okay, so we have some constraints, like, so first one is, so this I of pi is zero, this I of pi is zero, ideally. And another one is, so what is this value of this I of pi? What is the value of this I of pi? So I of pi, so where this pi, right? So this one, So this is equal to, so where we can equalize this. So where this point is identical to.
Minus I of 0.
Yeah. So this one, right? So these two are at same point, right? So because one cycle is completed, this is 0 to pi and this is pi to 2 pi. So this I of pi is minus of I of 0. Minus of I of 0. Okay. Okay. So now solve these three equations and obtain this phi value. Solve these three equations, obtain this phi value in terms of this beta and in terms of this beta and d. Okay, we can substitute d here, right? So now solve these three equations and obtain phi value in terms of beta and d. So d is already discussed, right? D is v naught dash by v I, right? V naught dash by v I. We have some initial conditions. So I of 0 is 0 and I of pi is minus I naught. Okay. So if you solve that, so you will get this phi s, right? So this phi s 1 by 2 minus beta minus b into phi. 1 by 2 into beta minus b phi. Okay. So beta is the pulse width of this VAB waveform. And this phi is the phase shift between these two input and output side. So D is the, what is D? D is the voltage gain referred to the primary side. Okay. So we have the power transfer between this, right, or the power output. So we can define like this, P naught is VI into II, VI into II. Right. So what is II? So this is VI into II, or this V naught into I naught. So both gives you same thing in ideal cases. So either VI into II or V naught into I naught. If you solve this one for II, and this will be something like this. So it is d VI square by 4 omega L into 2 beta minus pi d square minus beta square by pi. So this is the power output. This is the power output or the power input in ideal cases. So both are same. We assume that the efficiency is 100%. Right. So based on this, only this charger rating is fixed. So based on this, the charger rating is fixed. If we assume that it is a 10 kilowatt charger, so we have to make sure that, so this value is 10 kilowatt. So accordingly, we need to adjust the other parameters. So here II is the average value of this inductor, this one, right? And the input and output filter capacitances and So we can also have the KVA rating of the transformer. You can also have the KVA rating of the transformer. So generally, when you're calculating the KVA rating, in especially this nonlinear, which is involved, right? So normally we have the formula is V RMS, V primary side RMS and secondary side RMS, right? V RMS into I RMS or V secondary into I secondary. So that is the usual formula. So we have, so but when you are involving these power electronics and other non-linear equipment, so the formula will be slightly modified. So it is 1/2 times V primary into I primary plus V secondary into I secondary. The same formula, so the difference is, so where we are included the both primary powers and secondary powers, and we are taking the average of these two. So this VRMS and IRMS are the instantaneous, not instantaneous. These are the RMS values. So these are the RMS value of this inductor current. I primary and I secondary are the inductor currents on the primary and the secondary side, or the winding current of the primary and secondary sides. Okay. So in case of normal transformer, we, the formula is usually V primary into I primary or V secondary into I secondary. So, but here the formula will be primary into I primary plus V secondary into I secondary by 2. So it will be, if you have calculated that, so it will be like this. So VI So this is the RMS value of inductor current, RMS value of this inductor current. Okay, this is the RMS value of this inductor current. So I'm not going to discuss its derivation, so it's not that much important. So only thing we need to remember that the power output is, so this is the formula for the power output, and this is the rating of the KVA rating of the transformer. So next thing is, at what point of, right, at what point of D, so the maximum power, so that can be happening is, so usually here these values are fixed because the secondary side we have this diode bridge rectifier, right? So therefore, at D equal to 0.85, at D equal to 0.85, the maximum power transfer, so that is occurs for beta equal to 180 degree, and B is, D is 0.58, so then there is a maximum power, so that is transferred from this source to load side. Okay, a beta equal to 180 degrees, so that means the width of the pulse is 180 degrees and the D is 0.58, so at that point, so we can expect some maximum power transfer. So this waveform is corresponding to D equal to 1, this 0.9. So where we have this, this is corresponding to D equal to 0.58. So where we can expect some maximum efficiency. So these are evaluated based on some numerical values. So there is no certain proof for this. So at that point of time, so we have the transformer, this is the power capability, somewhere around 64% of the power that can be transferred from the primary and secondary side. So this is about this phase shifted case, phase shifted edge bridge. So how much power that is being transformed? The thing is to remember that, so this one and this one we need to remember. So most of the cases we have this usually when you are battery charger, most of the cases we have instead of this another H bridge on this other side. So we usually have diode bridge rectifier. How much power the charger is having or how much power that is charger ready. So that basically decides by this formula. Okay. So you need to remember or we need to understand this much only for this. So we have other ones, right? So this is where you have unidirectional power flow, and this one will be the bidirectional power flow. So here we have bidirectional power flow. So everything is same, the control wise and the operation wise, so everything is same, right? So where here phi is the phase angle, so between this primary and secondary, so that will dictate the power transfer between the source to load side, right? So phi will basically dictate the power transfer between the load to source side or source to load side. So in case of this one, so usually phi will be fixed, right? So what are the factors that are affecting this phi is this inductor and this load. Okay. And here the power flow is usually unidirectional. The power flow is unidirectional. So whereas here, everything is same, just we replaced this one with another H-bridge. This replaced with another H-bridge. So it is known as DAB, dual active bridge rectifier. Okay. So this is known as dual bridge rectifier. This is known as dual bridge rectifier, and this is dual active bridge rectifier. So why this term active? Because the power flow can be bidirectional with this. Okay, that is means it is acts as active front end or active back end. So here the main difference is this phase shift angle phi we can actually control. So where here this phase shift angle or the power flow we cannot control. So where in this case, the phase shift angle, this phi can be controlled by the switching pulses. Okay, we can control the phase shift angle phi. Okay, so that is the major difference between these two. So this is bidirectional and this phase angle can be controlled. So that means we can control the power flow from primary side to secondary side. So whereas the power flow control cannot be possible. With this, the power control can't be possible. So the main applications for this one is solid state transformers. Okay, so this is actually a DC to DC converter, right? Here we have input is DC and the output is also DC. So how this thing is used in a transformer, right? We have front end for this one, so where you have this AC to DC conversion. Okay. And this is high frequency transformer, so that will provide galvanic isolation, but it is operating at a high frequency of around 100 kilohertz, somewhere around between 50 to 100 kilohertz. And this DC is obtained, and DC is again fed to AC. Okay, so that means it acts as a transformer, so where you have AC to AC conversion, but the isolation is provided with a high frequency means high frequency link is there, right? So here you have high frequency link. So by using this, the main advantage is, the basic advantage is its size will be reduced. Okay. In most of the cases, its size will be reduced up to 80%. With conventional transformer, the size will be reduced up to 80%. So that all depends on how much capacity you are operating and how much switching frequency you are operating. So that all depends, or that will all dictate the size of this solid state transformer. Okay, so theoretically you can practically you can reduce up to 80% reduction in the size, because where the reduction is achieving, So normal core transformer, right, and high frequency transformer, so usually the size will be reduced up to 90%. Okay. The rest of the things, we have these power converters on both sides, so that may be amount for this another 10%. So therefore, we can practically reduce its size by 80%. Okay. So that is one thing. So where you already discussed this phi, so that will allow to power flow between the primary side and the secondary side. So in both, I mean, the secondary side of the power can be controlled. So another advantage is some normal conventional transformer, so we cannot operate at unity power factor, right? So conventional transformers, we cannot operate at unity power factor. So, but with this, you can operate at unity power factor. You can operate at unity power factor, and conventional power factor means conventional transformers, we have some of the drawback. So the drawback is reactive power, and there is a voltage regulation on the secondary side. Sometimes if you have an inductive load on a far away from the transformer load, when the load is connected from far away, or when the transformer is highly loaded, so under certain cases we can experience some voltage dips, right? And if it is in a capacitive load, we can experience some voltage rises, right? So all these things can be addressed in this solid state transformers. Right, so that means we can maintain at zero voltage regulation. We can operate this with zero voltage regulation. So unity power factor operation, zero voltage regulation, and size reduction. So apart from these other things, we can also operate this as an active power filter or some auxiliary services, like active power filtering, and some load is distorted, right? So this can be used as active power or compensation, or active power, it can operate as active power filter. Okay. And another important thing is, so we can convert this into a smart transformer. So we can convert this into a smart transformer. So when you say it's smart, we can actually control this transformer from the outside, right? Or we can control from a third person, and we can monitor this transformer data. So how much current that actually flowing, and how much power is being flowing, and how to turn on and turn off at certain intervals. So load scheduling and every other thing can be possible by making it smart. Okay. So these are the advantages. So with the solid state transformer, the basic thing behind the solid state transformer is this dual active bridge rectifier, or this dual active bridge converter. So we'll discuss more on the next class. So you have any questions? You have any questions?